Me and Katya are always in search for passionate people in Japan to share their stories, vision, inspiration, as well as some tricks with our listeners. You probably heard about MEXT Scholarship, the most prestigious and competitive scholarship for studying in Japan. For many people aspiring to come to live in Japan, it is unimaginable to do so without MEXT. Our today's guest has coached and answered questions to more than 1,000 applicants of MEXT and condensed all of his knowledge and experience into his guide, How to Apply for the MEXT Scholarship. It is amazing how not only he has published a whole book and made a blog, but he's also till today answering any possible question that you might have about MEXT and living in Japan. It is my honor to introduce you to Travis Senzaki, an international educator with expertise in Japanese higher education and Japanese government scholarships. On this episode of Tokyo State of Mind, you're going to learn how to be a successful applicant for MEXT 2020. Hi, Travis. It is great to see you. I'm so happy you agreed to participate in our podcast.
Hi. Well, thank you for inviting me. You know, nothing makes me happier than hearing that someone has been able to use the blog or the book to achieve success with the MEXT Scholarship. So I'm very happy to hear that and to talk to both of you today.
I'm happy you joined us today. So, Travis, for those who are considering studying in Japan, could you please briefly explain what the MEXT Scholarship is, actually?
Sure. So the MEXT Scholarship is a scholarship offered by the Japanese government. There are multiple levels. You can get it for undergraduate, you can get it for a graduate degree. There are other types of scholarships for a one-year exchange or for teachers training. But I focus on the MEXT Scholarship for graduate students because that is what I worked with, and it is also the largest scholarship with the most places. So it's a full scholarship. It covers all of your tuition for the course of your degree and also pays you a stipend between 143,000 to 145,000 Japanese yen per month. And also a round-trip air ticket from your home country to Japan. So it's quite a lucrative scholarship. You can actually extend the scholarship while you're in Japan. So if you were to start off as a non-degree, non-matriculated student at the master's level, extend that into a master's degree, and then extend that to a PhD, you could actually end up with over 10 million yen in just stipend payments over the course of 5 or 6 years, which not a bad amount of money to be paid. It's can be maybe a little bit tight living on that amount of money, but in rural Japan, that's more than enough to live on. So
yeah, that's true. Tokyo is an expensive city, so but still, it's enough to like live on your own. Like you can pay for the dorm, for the commuting pass. Yeah, it's like valuable.
I guess also for those people who are like nervous about coming to Japan during Corona times and thinking that, oh, I cannot find a part-time job during this time, we can assure that by MEXT, you can live a full life like without any need to do baito or do any kind of like extra activities to earn some cash.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. You're probably going to have a lot more financial resources at your disposal than your Japanese classmates will.
Yeah, maybe that's true. Okay. So many of us know you as a helpful person who give a lot of advices about MEXT scholarship, but actually no one has idea about your background. How did you get to Japan and how which experience brought you to idea of helping people about MEXT scholarship? So could you please describe us?
Sure, I'd be happy to. So I first came to Japan as a high school exchange student for a year with the Rotary Youth Exchange Program. So I spent 1 year and rotated between 4 host families over the course of that time. Yes, and it was kind of random. The Rotary program doesn't let you choose your country that you're going to. You get to choose a list of 10 countries and they pick one off there. So I didn't know very much about Japan when I was assigned to come here. And I found out with about 2 months' notice that I was going to Japan for a year. Yeah. So I had no Japanese language ability, didn't know much about it, had to learn very quickly. But it ended up being the best experience of my life. I grew up in a very small town, so it was my first time really leaving my community, leaving my country. Yeah. I learned a lot about myself and a lot about Japan and really felt at home here. And I finally managed to come back in 2011. My wife and I moved back here, and I was fortunate enough to find a job working with international students at a Japanese university. So my first job for 3 years there was processing all of the MEXT scholarship applications for that university.
That's why you know all the procedures about MEXT and yeah, I see.
Yes, so I got to know the scholarship from the reviewing side, not the application side. And my predecessor in my job, he actually quit the job because he used what he learned to get the MEXT scholarship.
Whoa.
So he quit the job, applied, and got the MEXT scholarship.
Yeah, I see.
That's a way to go.
So I did that for 3 years, and typically I would see about 50 to 60 embassy recommended MEXT scholarship applications every year with students looking for the letter of acceptance, and 200 to 250 university recommended MEXT scholarship applications. So in that time I worked with nearly 1,000 applicants, and because I was working at the university side, there wasn't much I could do to help the applicants. You know, I was just having to process it. I had to treat everybody the same way. I couldn't show any favoritism. And over, I saw the same mistakes, or I saw the same confusion or the same struggles. And I saw also that the information that MEXT and the university were putting out about the scholarship wasn't very good. It wasn't very complete. It left a lot of questions. And in fact, most of the mistakes were probably because the information was bad. So I wanted to do something about that. And when I left that job, then I started writing the blogs about my experience.
And wow, sounds great. Good start.
Yes.
Yeah, like that's so true that the embassy sometimes is like really vague about information. So you have to make your own research about things, like ask your senpais around, go to visit your blog, like and do all this different extra activities like to find this information that you need to apply. And like for this time that you were, all the time that you were working for MEXT and writing your blog, what were the common mistakes that you've noticed that people make when they apply to MEXT?
There were a lot of simple things about just not understanding what the forms were or what they had to submit. Not understanding those requirements. And I was the first person to receive the application and check it. So I'd be going through and make sure, okay, is the application form actually complete? Are all the questions answered properly? You know, there are things like counting the numbers of years of schooling you've had that it's really, the way they explain it, it's really bad. So, you know, if your school year is 9 months long, applicants were counting that as 9 months. But in Japan, that would count as a full year. So things like that.
Yeah.
Or students who didn't understand that, you know, they have to meet all of the eligibility requirements, which seems kind of a silly thing to say, but some people didn't understand that it wasn't most, it was, you know, all of them, or people thinking that they might be exempt from submitting a few forms and trying to work with that. One of the biggest challenges was with medical information form. Sometimes doctors would say, oh, you don't need the x-ray. But the Japanese university isn't going to accept the form without the x-ray.
So,
which is, no, your doctor doesn't actually have that discretion. The form has to be complete.
I mean, for me, probably the medical paper was the most complicated one, because in Russia, doctors didn't want to fill in the form, which is written not in Russian language. And yeah, you have to go find a doctor or go to some private clinic. So yeah, it was complicated procedure here. So yeah. I can see the struggles of committee also.
So those were kind of the basic mistakes, but there was a lot of, I don't know, less mistakes and more misunderstandings and confusion. So one of the biggest ones I saw was the word research student. So MEXT calls the scholarship for graduate students the MEXT scholarship for research students. And it's because in Japanese, kenkyusei, which is the word for graduate student, translates directly to research student. It really means student who's enrolled in a kenkyuka, which translates to graduate school. So it really should be graduate students, but they use research students. And then when you go to the university, they use the word research student to mean something else entirely. So the university uses it to refer to students who are not matriculated to the degree program. So students who are auditing or enrolled but not part of the degree. Mm. So students would be, well, I want to apply for the scholarship for a PhD, but you only have a scholarship for research students. No, a PhD is part of a research student. It's just bad wording.
Yeah, like I'm a research student too, and oftentimes I also don't understand what am I pretty much like. So it is like I can imagine how it is confusing for those who are just applying, because it is definitely a very vague term and people should not be afraid of it. Pretty much it's just like a preparation for the program, and then you're going to be enrolled in the program if you want to.
Mm-hmm. Right. So most cases it's essentially a pre-graduate student. So before you've taken the entrance exam and been matriculated. But once you start the program, you've got a limited number of years to finish it. So, you know, if you have that research student semester or year in advance, then that helps you get acclimated to Japan, start your research. And sometimes I think you can transfer those credits to count towards your degree as well. So it's beneficial.
Like people think about that they will come to Japan and they will like quickly get the skills of Japanese language, like they have this course, intensive course in the university, and they will be able to write whole research in Japanese language, for example. Yeah, does it often happen?
That was something we saw a lot, yeah. I think probably the number one reason that we rejected applicants for the embassy recommended MEXT scholarship was because they were trying to apply to a course that was taught in Japanese when they didn't have any Japanese language ability. The applicants would come and say, well, but I spend the first semester in an intensive Japanese language program, so shouldn't I be able to take a degree in Japanese? Mm. I'm sorry, but you know, 6 months is not going to be enough to get to the point where you can write a master's thesis or a PhD dissertation in Japanese.
Not even a year, I would say.
Yes.
No. Right.
So that was a big source of confusion.
Okay.
Did you two go through that program?
Intensive Japanese language course. Yes, but I mean, you can like use Japanese in daily conversation, but not in your research, because there is a specific vocabulary and the writing like rules. I don't know how to say, but yeah, it's extremely difficult to be a scientist in Japanese language. So yeah, yes. I'm using English to write my research. Yeah, so yeah. And what about I often heard that students are really concerned about their like research plan and not thinking about what does Japan need or what do I personally need. So that other is like misconception about like this research plan, like what are common mistakes students make?
Yeah, I think I see this most often at the master's level, where students are coming right out of a bachelor's degree and the email said, well, I don't know. I don't know what I'm going to research yet. Mm-hmm. How can I know what I'm going to research when I haven't even been enrolled in a university, when I haven't even met my advisor? And that's a perfectly valid point, but that's not the point of writing a research plan for the application. And so I think that's one thing that students really misunderstand and isn't well explained. When you write the field of study and research program plan, that's probably not your final thesis proposal. Probably not what your final thesis research is going to look like, and that's okay. The point of that is to show that you can write a competent research plan, essentially.
Right.
You know what research looks like in your field of study. If you were to be able to write a complete research proposal for your master's thesis or your PhD dissertation before even enrolling in the university, the chances are pretty good you don't need to enroll in the university. Because otherwise, what are you learning over those 2 years?
Yeah,
why do you have an advisor? So students get really worried about that. But it's not something you have to worry about. Your research plan is going to change. And that's totally fine.
Right. So actually, I have my personal question. So I had an experienced a confusion about my research plan. So I wanted to study water pollution after Fukushima nuclear accident. But one of my friends, he said that this topic might be too compromising because Japan didn't admit this pollution happened. So I might lose my chance to get the scholarship. So to play safe, I changed my research topic to general water pollution. So what would your advice be on these kind of questions, and what are the common fears that students have?
It's a very difficult situation, certainly, because technically they can't say, technically, you know, researching water pollution would not be a prohibited research topic.
Right.
But the problem you run into is that these are people evaluating your research plan. And especially if you're applying to the embassy, then you're looking at government bureaucrats who are part of this evaluation process, and they're going to have their own opinions. So if you approach something controversial, they might start to look for reasons to find, or other reasons to find ways to, you know, discount your plan or to lower your application score. Mm. You know, they might look at you a little bit more critically. So I think it was probably a good idea to avoid a politically sensitive topic in that sense. And apparently it worked for you. So
yeah, right. So be accurate at some point is necessary. Okay, thank you. Yeah.
Once you get through that stage, and once you get talking to your advisor, I think the professors are probably a little bit more forgiving about topics like that. Mm. Maybe not as politically sensitive. So once you know, like I said, your research plan is going to change. You always have the chance to go back to that topic later.
All right. So I could choose like a general water pollution and then go to Japan, come to my professor and like say directly, I want to study water pollution after Fukushima nuclear accident, something like this. And if he agreed, that would be great. Yeah.
Okay. At that point, you've already got the scholarship. The worst thing your professor can say is, no, I don't want to supervise that topic. But they're not going to turn around and kick you out and say, no, no scholarship for you.
I see. Right. What are the other fears that like this kind of, people make a lot of mistakes and because they're nervous, they think they have little chance to win the scholarship. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I do see people worry that maybe their field of study isn't going to be highly valued. Mm-hmm. So I'll often have applicants who are in, say, fine arts, say, hey, I want to apply for the MEXT scholarship, but are they really going to select me if I'm going up against an engineer? Mm-hmm. And so they're really worried about that. My research doesn't look as valuable. Mm-hmm. And then they end up writing their field of study and research program plan, so it's almost entirely defensive. You know, like they're writing from a state of already being weak. You know, they're writing like, oh, well, the committee's not going to like me anyway. And it's not something you should worry about. Sometimes there are situations where the country will say, we're only accepting applicants in this field of study. But if they're not saying that, then everyone has the same chance. Mm-hmm. And it's up to you to really sell the topic and say, this is why this is valuable. I've seen people get the MEXT scholarship in fine arts. In fact, one of the blogs that I took inspiration from when I was starting mine, there was a gentleman in 2008, I think, who won the MEXT scholarship in fine arts. And he wrote about his experience and he shared his research plan that won the scholarship.
Really?
So, yeah.
Wow.
It seems to be possible. So one thing that I think might help is understanding what the MEXT scholarship is supposed to do for Japan. Because it's not just something where they're being generous and giving money to people. Mm. Japan has a purpose for this scholarship too.
Of course.
Yeah. It's essentially soft power. So it's a way to develop leaders around the world in other countries who have fond feelings towards Japan. Mm. You know, they bring some of the top scholars, because it's a merit-based scholarship. So they bring some of the top scholars and top leaders from countries around the world educate them and train them in Japan, get people thinking positively about Japan, then send them back to be leaders in their home countries. And so that helps feed, you know, people they influence, or they have their network of researchers in Japan, and now they can expand that network to their home country. So you can benefit that. You can meet that goal. You can try to explain how you're going to be a great asset for Japan as an engineer, certainly. Hey, I'm going to go back and I'm going to, you know, work on this pipeline, or I'm going to work on this water filtration plant or device. And, you know, the people that I work with in my home country, they'll know this research came to Japan. I will link them with my former researchers in Japan, and we'll have that strong connection. Or you can go and say, the line art, the fine arts applicant, you know, he took what he learned of Japanese art and went back and he incorporated that into manga that he was drawing and making popular in America. And so spreading Japanese culture, spreading awareness of Japan that way.
That's cool. Yeah.
There's a lot of different ways you can do it. So you just have to look at, how can I find a benefit to Japan and my home country from this research? And if you can do that, then you have a chance.
Yeah, that's right.
You basically have to know, just like everywhere else, how to sell yourself, how to present yourself in the way that will make you look good for them.
Right. So it's not Japanese, but there's the famous quote by Sun Tzu, which is, if you know yourself and you know your enemy, then in 1,000 battles, you need not fear defeat.
Oh, yeah.
So I think about it, if you're going to the next application, if you know yourself, if you know your strengths, if you know, I wouldn't say enemy, but opponent, you know what you're going up against, you know what the embassy wants. And if you can match those two, then you should have nothing to fear. You can make a good strategy and apply for the scholarship.
Wow, that's a great advice. I cannot agree more on that. It's just, actually, I think that's the right it's about mindset. If you set this mindset right from the start, everything else is just like, you know, little details pretty much.
Yes.
I see. So apart from like the fears of people that their field of study might not be relevant, or that they stand this little chance, what can you say about the communication problems that people have? I'm sure that a lot of people write to your blog. I think I was also the one who wrote to your blog like a long time ago about the timing when to contact professors, because at that time I was not really familiar that much with the Japanese culture, so I didn't know how to, you know, how to represent myself, like, and how to make sure that I'm not bothering people. And I think you probably get a lot of questions like that. So how would you advise for people to deal with that situation?
Yeah, reaching out to professors to see if they're willing to be your advisor or to start networking can be one of the most frightening and nerve-wracking parts of the application process, I think. So yeah, one of the questions I get a lot, in fact, I think I just answered one this morning on the blog, was, when should I contact my professor? And there are several different answers. So on one hand, I would say as early as possible. As soon as you have your research idea, as soon as you have kind of the vague outline of your research plan, then it's okay to reach out to your professor and start networking as someone who wants to study under them, not as a MEXT scholarship applicant. It's really important to know how to approach them when. So first, reaching out, if you're reaching out before the application, I recommend, you know, reaching out and just trying to connect based on mutual interest and respect for their research. You don't want to reach out and say, hi, you know, I'm Travis and I want to apply for the MEXT scholarship, so will you be my advisor? A lot of applicants do that, and you're not making a positive impression that way. It's like, wait, you're just using me to get the scholarship. So if you bring some sort of value proposition to the relationship with the professor, if you find some way where you're going to offer value, is like, hey, I'm really excited in your research and I want to do this research that is related and I think we'll have some mutual benefit. Do you think this could work? If you approach it from that, then yes, I recommend as soon as possible.
As soon as possible. But I think I heard some cases about, like, if you contact the professor, mm-hmm. and the professor asks you, what time, like, what stage have you passed? If you say, like, I'm just applying, so professor won't, like, can mm-hmm. talk with you. He doesn't want to talk with you because, yeah, you haven't passed the exams or something like this. Is this, like, how to deal with this kind of problem, or just keep searching another, like, never stop searching, or just focus on your exams, for example? What?
Yeah. Well, some universities actually have that as a policy. You know, the professors will not respond to applicants, to MBC recommended MEXT scholarship applicants, before they have passed the primary screening. So that's nothing personal. Some applicants, like, they'll get that and say, oh, this professor hates me. No, it's university policy. Don't worry. Once you pass the primary screening, they'll be perfectly happy to talk to you.
Sure.
But especially if you contact professors right around when the application process is going on, that might raise flags, and they're going to say, well, okay, is this person a MEXT scholarship applicant? Because 5 other MEXT scholarship applicants contacted me this week. But if it's off cycle, so if you're reaching out in, like, February or March, or, you know, over the winter or something like that, when it's not MEXT application season, then they might not make that connection right away. But yeah, if it does happen, they say, well, are you a MEXT scholarship applicant? And if so, we can't communicate until after you pass the primary screening. That's fine. That's not going to be a disadvantage to you.
Mm-hmm.
You can always contact that professor later. But in the meantime, yeah, why not try to reach out to other professors who might be more communicative? No, the one other concern I see a lot is applicants say, I emailed this professor a week ago and they haven't responded. What should I do? And sometimes I'll write back and say, it's final exam week. The professor's probably doesn't have the time.
Yes.
Or it's a university vacation. There's a good chance they're not even checking their email. So if someone writes that in, like, March, I said, well, try again in April once school's back in session. Some applicants are worried, is it okay to send a reminder email? And yes, I think, you know, after a week, if you can send a polite reminder email. Some of the reminder emails I've gotten in the past were less than polite, but I'm not a professor, so what I thought doesn't matter. But
okay,
I write back, like, you don't want to talk to professors this way.
Sure, right. Yeah, that was very good advices, and we have talked a lot about mistakes and fears, but let's talk about how to become actually a winner. What do the mindset the winners have, like, how to mm-hmm. be a winner?
Yeah, well, we talked a little bit earlier about, you know, knowing what MEXT wants out of the scholarship, so that's really important to keep in mind. But I think, you know, the mindset that really makes a difference is applicants treating it like it's a job or like it's a professional endeavor. Not just going out and saying, well, hey, what the heck, I'll apply. You know, like I mentioned earlier, you can earn potentially 10 million yen in stipend from this scholarship over the course of a few years. So consider what you would do if you were applying for a job that was going to pay you that and give you a degree. And take it just as seriously. So, you know, focus, make sure that everything you compile is quality, that you're meeting all of the requirements. And the most important thing, I think, is to have kind of a common application theme. So what I encourage applicants to look at is think of how you're going to serve the world, how you're going to serve the relationship between Japan and your country. And specifically, something you might be able to do within 5 years after graduation. Base your goal off that. Okay, in order to achieve that, what do you need to study? What do you need to research that will help prepare you for that? And then from there, okay, what university is best for you to do that? So really working back from that goal and keeping everything together on a common theme, a common message that's very clear and straightforward, I think that's a very powerful mindset to approach it.
Yes, Actually, speaking about being serious, I remember myself. So I have passed from the second attempt. My first attempt, I wasn't serious. I mean, I was serious, but I underestimated the competition, the level of the MEXT scholarship requirements. So after first time I failed, I realized my mistakes and I really take it for like seriously. Yeah, that's a very useful advice because yeah, prepare as for the job. Yeah, that's true. I absolutely agree with you.
Yeah, I'm glad you didn't give up.
Yeah, I really wanted to come and I really wanted to study this topic in Japan. Yeah, that's good.
Well, and that's actually a good point because another question I get a lot is, you know, students say, well, I have a you know, 2.97 GPA on the MEXT scale. What are my chances? Mm-hmm. Well, it depends. And that's an answer I get all the time in Japan. It depends. But it depends on the competition because it's not a matter of just being good enough to meet the qualification. You have to be better than the other applicants. You have to be clear, clearer, or make a stronger impression.
So. Yeah, yeah, that's right. And actually, another thing that I was thinking about is to show them that you're interested in their country, not only like conducting research in Japan, but also in Japanese culture, because they want you to make sure that you understand the culture, that you can live there for some time. So. Mm-hmm. Like during my interview, I mentioned that I like temari, like making this round ball stitches, embroidery thing and other stuff. So yeah, I think this is useful. This is helpful, like to share, to show you're interested, not only in research, but in country generally.
Yes. And it's pretty impressive that you can say temari. And that you're interested in that's a very niche area of Japanese culture. A lot of applicants will say, well, you know, I like Pokemon. Okay, go a little deeper.
Yeah, I didn't want to mention anime, manga, because of course we're all interested in this part of culture, but we want to make an impression go deeper, right? So, yeah, sure. I wanted to do so.
So if you can say something like temari, then say, okay, temari. Well, you've looked at Japanese culture pretty in-depth.
Okay.
I don't know, like, how about the, like, you know, testing the interest for culture, but somehow what I felt from my embassy is that they're also testing how mentally prepared you are to go abroad and like spend over 2 years in a foreign country. So I remember when I was going through the interview, they looked at my resume and they said, oh, like you've already been to an exchange program. Like that's good. Because I also heard a lot of stories of some people coming from MEXT and having like a very heavy form of a cultural shock and not being able to proceed with their studies. Of course, like there are not many cases like this, but it still happens. And I think it is really important to appeal to your embassy and that you are not going to waste their efforts, that you really can survive mentally in a new space.
Right. That's, yeah, absolutely important. And sometimes, you know, a lot of applicants will come in where they don't necessarily have any experience as in-depth with Japanese culture or Japanese language, or they haven't been to Japan, of course, but any experience where you can show that you've adapted to a new culture or adapted to a new situation. You moved from the countryside into the city and were able to adapt to that, or you visited another country, or you've, you know, welcomed international students who were in your country and become best friends with them and show them all around. Any way you can show that you have some sort of intercultural competence and you're more likely to survive that culture shock, that's absolutely going to be helpful. Yes.
Actually, I just remembered another thing that I said on interview. So I attended Japanese Japan Foundation. Do you know this organization? Mm-hmm. So they provide free Japanese language classes in Moscow. So mm-hmm. I've been attending these classes for the 2 or 3 years. And when Prime Minister Abe came to Moscow for some political conference, I don't know what time of conference was that, we were invited to the meeting with his wife. So Abe-san. So I mentioned about that meeting on the interview. So yeah, they were a little bit impressed, but I think like these kind of things should be mentioned because they support your idea that you're interested. Yeah, in Japan.
For people who are applying in the future, if you can find some way to take, you know, free Japanese lessons or find an online Japanese conversation partner or something like that to show in advance of the application that you're working on your Japanese language skills or you're really interested in, you're actually taking steps on your own to study about Japan and Japanese language, that's going to make a positive impression, absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah. That's very true. And what do you think are the other tips like for MEX scholars to increase their chances of winning the scholarship?
Mm-hmm. One other thing I think was really helpful is the more research you can do on your own before asking questions to the university, the more you can show that you've prepared and are on top of things for the MC is going to be better. So, mm-hmm. you know, students will come, they would email me and ask, well, how do I do this? How do I find an advisor? Well, have you looked at our website? You know, mm-hmm. all the professors are listed on the website with their research interests. So being able to take those steps in advance, to think about, rather than just going to ask right away, you know, one thing we would kind of joke about on between the staff members of the universities is, it's a research scholarship, and this person isn't even researching our website.
So, that's fine.
Show a little bit of effort there. And you know, finding and identifying the professors can be part of the hardest part of the application. But sometimes you can find them on the website. It's often a lot easier if you can find them in Japanese, if you can access the Japanese side of the website, either using Google Translate or help from a friend. Usually the Japanese websites are a lot better than the English ones at most universities.
That's so true. Those are like, they, a lot of times those websites, they look like different websites because you just click and on the like English version and you see a more simplified version and you don't see anything that they have. Just even if you don't speak Japanese, just by the size of the text, you can see it's so different.
Yes.
So true. Speaking about finding a professor, so it's very, as you said, it's very important because this person will be your supervisor during a few coming years. So how to find the right supervisor? What is the best way?
Well, I think the way I recommend starting is looking for the research connection first. Obviously, you know, the closer your research connection and interests are, probably the easier you're going to get along. But beyond that, it is a matter of a personal relationship too. So start with the lab, start with trying to find the professor's research interest, start by then look at their publications or see if they have their own website. A lot of professors now will, or at least the younger professors, will have their own website. Sometimes it's only in Japanese, but if they have their own website and they've made an effort to put a little bit of it in English, at least, that's a great sign. Mm. Yeah, if the professor is publishing something in English, that's a good sign too. Mm. You know, look for things like that. They're going to be a little bit more receptive to international students.
Mm.
And this is a theory I tested with a friend of mine who is a professor at a university here, is professors who are younger and more junior in rank generally still have something to prove. You know, they're still moving up the career ladder. Mm-hmm. So they're going to be more active in publishing, more active in researching. They're probably now Japanese universities are really valuing internationalization. So they're going to be more interested in bringing international students into their labs or into their research teams. Whereas a professor who's extremely accomplished, has a lot of books published, is tenured, and kind of towards the end of his career or her career, maybe not so dynamic and accepting, maybe more stuck in their ways. Looking for someone who shows evidence of being active, being dynamic, trying new things, trying to make an effort in English. All of those are positive signs, I think, for someone who's going to be a good relationship for an advisor. If there's a senior professor who's an expert in your field and you really want to work with them, go for it. But you know, don't just choose the senior professor because they're senior.
Yeah, I think so many students are like concerned about like choose the experienced professor because this professor knows a lot. He has like information to give you and so on, but this kind of professor can be inactive, yeah, in some terms. Yeah, and I remember that I have contacted to one of professors, and she said that she could recommend me another professor who is my supervisor now. So she recommended me him, and yeah, that was so generous of her. So she help sometimes other professors help students to find the right way.
That's something else that's really important to look at too, is the communication you have with the professor during the application process. You know, if they're responding to you quickly, if they're proactive in their communication, if they're friendly in their communication, that's probably a good sign too.
That's very true. Yeah, I think a lot of people also maybe like underestimate how much of their control they also might have about this whole situation with professors, in the way that you are choosing for professors and professors are choosing you, but you still have control over it, in the way that depending on your goal, on why are you coming to Japan, you can choose your professor like depending on the vibe that you want. Like if you want a really serious professor and like study in your lab all the time, then you go for this kind of person. Or but if you have like, if you want to have a more I'm not saying like relaxed life, but more like flexible schedule and have an opportunity to do something outside of your studies, you also might look for somebody who is not that strict pretty much, and who is more open, and who will who will trust you like on like do your own work, I'm doing my own work, something like this.
Sure.
Yeah. Want it to be worthwhile for them.
So. Yeah.
And now we are here in 2020 and with all this corona pandemic and everything. So what are the main tips like to pass scholarship in 2020, like in this whole new situation? What is the situation and how people can overcome these obstacles to still get the chance to win scholarship and come to Japan?
One important thing to remember is if you're applying now for the embassy recommended MEXT scholarship, the earliest you're going to arrive in Japan is September or October 2021. So that's a lot of time for the corona situation to settle down. Right. You know, right now, Japan is not allowing immigration from, I think it's 117 countries. But hopefully over the course of the next year, that limitation will go away. So you've still got some time for that. This year, because of the coronavirus situation, the whole MEXT scholarship application process started late. So usually the guidelines come out in mid-April. This year, they came out in late May from MEXT. And then from there, the various embassies in the various countries started doing their own, putting together their own application plans. So I'm still seeing embassies last 2 days ago just say, hey, we've opened the MEXT scholarship application.
Really?
So right now, there might be applicants saying, what happened? It was supposed to be in April or May. I haven't seen anything. You know, there's a chance your country just hasn't started yet. Keep looking at that embassy website. I'm seeing a lot of the announcements on the embassy's Facebook pages too. So follow the Japanese embassy on Facebook in your country. And it's going to be different for each country right now based on what the coronavirus situation is there. Unfortunately, I heard that in Nepal, this year they've canceled the application process. The situation was just too bad. They couldn't have people travel to the capital to come to the embassy and take the tests or interview in person. And as far as I know right now, no place is saying that they're going to skip the interviews or skip the in-person tests. So it's going to have to be some travel for that. So it's going to be country by country whether or not they can handle it. But you know, keep following the information from your country's embassy. And if that doesn't work, there's always the university recommended MEXT scholarship. That's going to start usually about September, October. And the great thing about that one is it's all by mail. You don't actually have to do any traveling during that application process. So, you know, for applicants who couldn't make it in the embassy, that's a chance this year.
There is still a way to do it in this tough situation, right?
Yeah, which is amazing.
Yeah, which is cool. Yeah, during this tough time, could you please give us some advices or encouragement for those who are watching us now, maybe for future MEXT scholars? Yeah, so.
Yeah, of course. Well, going related to the coronavirus situation and kind of touching back on concerns over field of study and research program plan and whether your field is good or not, you know, worry about what's under your control. Focus on the things that you can fix, the things that you can control, the things that you can do excellent at. Don't worry about the things that are beyond your control, because it's going to happen one way or another. You know, you probably at this point can't go back and change your transcript and your grades. You know, you can't change what the coronavirus situation is in your country right now. All you can do is put together the best application that you can, make the best case you can for your country's embassy and for Japan, why you are going to be an asset to them, why you're going to be an excellent candidate for the scholarship, and just nail that part, nail what you can control, and let the rest fall as it will, I guess.
Yeah.
Wow, those are really wise and warm words. So a lot of our listeners will appreciate that. Like, thank you so much. Yeah.
Oh, of course.
Yeah.
I think everyone has a chance. As long as you're eligible, you've got a chance.
There were times when me and Katya probably were thinking that we don't have a chance, and yet we're here. So don't give up. It's all manageable. Just like believe in yourself and do what you can. And one last question that we have for Travis is like, how people can find you on social media, or what is the best way to connect with you?
For your listeners, I have put up a link for it's signup.transcendsjapan.com/TSM, and that will take you to a sign up page for my mailing list. And the mailing list, if you sign up for that, I'll send you the sample application forms, which, you know, how to fill in the different forms. And I also have a kind of a starter email course that introduces the MEXT scholarship little by little over a couple weeks. And just helps, you know, students get acquainted with it, and also links to some of the relevant articles on the blog. So hopefully that's helpful for people.
Okay.
Yeah. We'll put all those links under the description of this video, so you can go just click directly and go to visit this page, which probably has even more information like to offer, except for what you heard today. Thank you so much, Travis. It was really great to talk to you, and this advisors are just like, I cannot stop stressing how important and how wonderful they are. And if you want to see more interesting people like Travis, then subscribe to our podcast on YouTube, Tokyo State of Mind, and follow our Instagram, Tokyo State of Mind official page, where you can find more tips and tricks on living in Japan from us and our guests. See you next week.